Hey guys, in this video, we're gonna be going over the XLR audio module for the Sony FX3, and this also applies to the K3M module as well, but we're gonna connect everything you see here, including a professional mixer, we have shotgun mics, condenser mics, we have professional wireless packs, consumer wireless packs, a lot to go over, so stick around. Hey guys, Ray Valencia here, back with another Sony FX3 video. And on this channel, we go over my experiences of working full-time in Florida in television production through gear, editing, tutorials, the whole nine yards. So if that's something that you're into, please consider subscribing. So as a person that was already saving up for the A7S III and the K3M audio module, when the FX3 was announced with this audio handle interface built in, it was a no-brainer for me because I was already gonna get those things. So the interface on this audio module is exactly the same as the K3M, except on the back of this handle, there is no option for digital or analog because this handle is only made for this camera, which is digital interface. The K3M is backwards compatible with the A7R III and the older cameras because you're able to do an analog signal as well. The other difference being that on the K3M, it also comes with the microphone, the Sony ECM XM1 microphone, and the FX3 does not come with a microphone, and they probably anticipated that being that most filmmakers have their own shotgun microphone that they want to integrate with it. So what it really comes down to with this handle is how thick your microphone is. So this battery powered microphone is a little bit thicker, but this Phantom powered microphone, the Sennheiser, is a little bit thinner and more low profile. So the problem that I've had with this XLR handle is that they made this little ring here that holds your microphone just a little bit too wide, which is probably the size of the Sony microphones. So what you end up having to do is get one of these little rubber rings, which I found these on eBay. They were like $2 for $7. So you can go on eBay or somewhere and get you some of these rubber rings that go around your shotgun microphone and make it fit a little bit better. So you can see the different thicknesses. This is just a cheap battery powered microphone, and this is a really expensive MKH416 microphone. So super professional microphone, doesn't quite fit in here, but this cheap battery powered one does. So this is it without the rubber grip. Loose. But then whenever you put this rubber ring on this size microphone, it actually fits perfectly, and there's no slipping or sliding or bouncing, like it's in there good. So that's the ideal size microphone for this. If not, you just need to find some thicker rubber spacers, and it may take some trial and error to figure out the exact size to get, but this is definitely an option that works instead of using gaff tape. Like I see a lot of people using gaff tape on these things to get it to fit, but they do make rubber rings out there that fit. Like this is a perfect example of this little condenser mic, and look at that, it's on there, there's no shake, it's on there really good. All right, so before we get into connecting all this stuff to our camera and our camera settings and all that stuff, we need to go over how to actually use the functions and everything on the handle itself. So let's dive into that now. So here is the power button for the handle. So it is set to off here, and you actually push this little tab in and move it over to power on the handle. And on this side, you have input 1, 2, and 3. And these connections are XLR and they support 1/4 inch as well. And lastly, you have your 3.5 millimeter jack at the top. And on the bottom side of the handle, there's actually a couple little spaces to hold your cables there as well. And there's also a micro USB port underneath the handle for probably updating it in the future. On the back of the audio handle, you have your input selector for channels 1 and 2. So when it's set to input one will actually be on channels 1 and 2. When you put it on input 1 and 2, it'll split channel 1 on input 1 and channel 2 on input 2. When you select input 3 as the priority, it will put the left and right channels of input 3, your 3.5 millimeter jack, on channels 1 and 2, and your input 1 and 2 will then go to inputs 3 and 4. But when you're using something in channel 1 and channel 2, keep it on input 1, input 2. Okay, so now we have our inputs and our input selector. Now let's go over the actual input controls on this side. So these are the gain controls for input 1, 2, and 3. And you can set each of them to automatic or manual. And the second channel, you can actually link to the first channel as well. If you wanna just use this knob to adjust them both, you can link those channels, or you can set this to manual and you can have a safety track at a lower decibel if you just lower the second mirrored channel right there. So you have channel 1 coming in at 5 and you have channel 1 mirrored at 3. So you have a backup safety track for just a single one channel microphone here. You see how there is a 5 that's highlighted on the dial here? Well, even on our Sony FS7, we keep it at a 5 as the baseline whenever we're coming into the unit from a mixer. But if you're coming into it with a straight microphone, you can definitely use this to adjust the gain of the mic coming into it. So this is the input selector, and this is where you select which type of audio is coming into inputs 1 or 2. So select line level when you're coming into the XLR unit from a mixer or like a DJ booth or something like that, because line level is much louder than mic level. So you have to set it to line level to accommodate for that loud sound coming into it. All right, so the next setting is mic level. So you set the handle to mic level whenever you're accepting sound from a microphone that has its own internal battery, like this condenser mic that takes double A's, or this Rode VideoMic Pro Plus, which has its own internal rechargeable battery here, or even the Rode Wireless Go, which has its own internal battery as well. And lastly, you set it to mic plus 48 volts whenever you have a microphone that doesn't have its own battery and requires 48 volts of phantom power. So in this case, it uses the camera's internal battery to power this microphone. So one thing to note is make sure you don't have the phantom power enabled whenever you're connecting a microphone that doesn't need external power so you don't mess up your microphone. So next up, you have the ATT switch, and this stands for attenuation. This is actually a super important switch for determining how much sensitivity your microphone is going to input into your camera. Attenuators decrease or increase the decibels of your input. So this lever is actually kind of confusing because it looks like it's an additional gain to add to your microphone, but 0 decibels is actually the noisiest. So when you're setting the attenuation to 0 decibels, you're actually setting it to negative 60 decibel units. And this is ideal for low sensitivity microphones, and it amplifies background noise. Now, when you set the attenuation to 10 decibels, this is actually Sony's recommended setting for ordinary microphones. This is for a standard input of negative 50 decibel units. And lastly, when you set it to 20 decibels, now you're actually at negative 40 decibel units, and this is for high sensitivity microphones with a very low noise floor. So overall, much quieter coming into the camera, but it also decreases the sound of the background noise and the microphone as well. But overall, it does sound a little bit cleaner, although Sony's recommended setting is to keep it at 10 decibels for any ordinary microphone. And the last setting on here is a noise reduction, and that's the low cut filter here. You have off, 100 kilohertz or 300 kilohertz, depending on what sound you're trying to get rid of. And you can get rid of sounds like air conditioning sounds or rumbles, vibrations, maybe like an electric, like building hum or just some kind of rumble in your sound. You can use the low cut filter there to get rid of it. But if you don't need it, just keep it off so you don't alter the sound of the person's voice if you don't need it. And one cool thing that they had video shooters in mind for, you can even adjust your gain dials while you have the door closed here. So if you're just run and gun shooting on the fly, you can still access these gain controls without even lifting this up or reaching up. You can just tell 1 is here, 2 is here, and 3 is back here. So that's everything as far as the switches and the dials and what they do. Now we need to see actually how they work by connecting different microphones and the mixer to the XLR handle itself. But first, we need to jump into the camera and enable our 4-channel audio setup in the camera. So let's jump into the studio and get that connected now. All right, now we're set up here in the studio. I thought it'd be a little better to do the test in here because I have the sound panels on the wall, so it'll sound a little better before we do these microphone settings and everything. So before we do that, let's go ahead and do the settings inside the camera. All right, so first thing, jump into the menu and go down to the shooting menu, which is the first menu, the red menu, and find your way down to number 6, audio recording, and go over into audio recording, which is on. As you can see, audio record level is now grayed out because input 3 is now on the handle instead of on the camera body. Although, if you plug a microphone into the camera body, it will override the camera handle and it will take precedence over that. So you'll only get the audio from the camera jack here and you'll get nothing out of the module here. So you can't run a 3.5 millimeter microphone into here and into the top handle. You can only do one or the other. Audio out timing, live or lip sync. We just leave it on live, so we don't ever mess with that. Okay, so find your way down to the multi-interface shoe audio set. And you can see here that I have the 4 channels enabled, 48 kilohertz, 24-bit. You can also do it with 2 channels. And then here you can see the 16-bit with only 2 channels. But we're gonna enable the 4 channels here. So next we go down to audio level display, which is on. That's just the audio bars that are on the main screen. We definitely wanna see that. All right, so let's get out of here. We go back to the main menu and go all the way down to the briefcase. And now we're gonna go down to option number 9, which is sound option. And once we enter that, you see the volume settings here for your headphones. We have it at 15. So this is your 4-channel audio monitoring, and a lot of people get confused here and they're not sure what they're hearing. So this is what your headphones are hearing. So right here you have channel 1, channel 2. I'm hearing that in both ears, the left and the right ear. So next I can go to 3 and 4, and now I'll only be hearing the Rode Wireless Go microphone. So that's here. So next I go down to 1 and 3 in my left ear and then 2 and 4 in my right ear. So now I can hear what's coming in on this microphone and I can hear what's coming in on this microphone. And if I had more mics, I would hear those as well. Or you can make it where you hear channel 1 in both ears or channel 2 in both ears, which I don't have anything connected to that. So I don't hear anything right now. So I like keeping it on 1 and 3 and 2 and 4 so I can hear everything going on at once. That's everything you need to know in camera. Now it's time to start connecting all these microphones. By the way, guys, if you're enjoying this video, be sure to hit the like button. Let me know that you're actually enjoying this content and if I should keep doing stuff like this. And leave me a comment if you have questions about anything, but all right, let's get back into this. I have the Sennheiser hooked into input 1 here with 48 volts phantom power. And then I have the Rode Wireless Go into the input 3 here. So now let's hook up another microphone, another Rode Wireless Go to the other XLR input using this 3.5 to XLR adapter made by Rode. So when you plug in the Rode Wireless Go, they come in super hot. So you have to turn them down. So this is the one in input 2 through XLR. So I'll just turn that one down a little bit and that microphone. So this is the Rode Wireless Go that is in input 2. And as you can see, 5 comes in way too hot. So I'm gonna turn that down just a little bit to roughly like, maybe like 3, 2.5. So I wanna show you, so I'm gonna turn these to 0. I'm gonna turn the Sennheiser to 0 and I'm gonna turn this microphone to 0. So now we are only focusing on input 2, the Rode Wireless Go number 2. Okay, so with this Rode Wireless Go here, I want to show you the differences between this attenuator switch here, because it doesn't work the way that you think it does probably, because it looks like it's like a boosted gain. It says 0, 10, and 20, like it's boosting your gain, but it's not. It's actually adjusting the sensitivity of your microphone. So if you have a microphone that is very low sensitivity and you need to boost the gain up in that, you need more sensitivity in the microphone. Oddly enough, you go to 0 decibels. And as you can see now, this audio level is super loud. Let me turn down the actual gain here. So this is with the high sensitivity mode. This is 0 decibels, and this is what it sounds like with the attenuator set to 0 decibels. Now we're gonna go down to the standard mode, which is 10 decibels. This is the mode that Sony recommends for ordinary microphones. And now you can see that my levels are coming in much lower, but it sounds pretty good though. So the noise floor is cleaned up a little bit and there's not too much noise in here. My voice still sounds really good. Now we're gonna go down to the 20 decibel mark, and this is actually the most aggressive as far as the noise reduction goes, because this is created for like a really sensitive microphone, like a high sensitivity mic. So let's say now that I had this mode on, and then I boost the actual gain knob up here to the standard 5 right here. So this is what it sounds like with the 20 decibel setting on the attenuator. All right, now let's say you wanna take your FX3 on a professional film set and you wanna record 4 channels from a mixer. So you get your audio mixer in, he sets up his boom pole here. This is on my input 3 on the mixer. And you also have a lavalier mic that's right here. This is input 1 on the mixer. You have this microphone here, which is input 2 on the mixer. So that's 3 channels going into the mixer and coming straight into channels 1 and 2 on the FX3. And I can hear all 3 channels coming into the camera, but they're only coming in on channels 1 and 2. This is going to mix everything down because you're only able to access channel 1 and 2. So everything is gonna be coming into channel 1. And then you can get a lower safety track on channel 2 if you want, or you can link those. And last but not least, now I have this Rode VideoMic Pro Plus. So 4 different sources going into the camera right now. So just having this audio module alone just makes it where you can take the FX3 into a professional environment and you could record these onto here, but knowing that you have the backup recording in the mixer where it separates all the channels out will be awesome as well, because you'll be able to sync it up in post. And that's what this tool is actually made for. Although it is awesome having all the inputs here on the actual camera itself, but you would need someone to record separate audio if there was more than 2 channels coming into the camera. Like if you had this 3rd channel here or this 4th channel here, definitely want to be recording separate audio as well, but you could have your scratch mic on here, the 3.5 millimeter Rode VideoMic Pro Plus, and still have the mixer running into the camera too. All right guys, hopefully this video helped you gain a little bit of insight on how to use the XLR handle for your Sony FX3, or maybe the K3M module for your A7S3. But if this video did help you out, be sure to hit that like button down below. I'll leave links to everything down below if you're interested in picking up any of these adapters or parts that you see in this video. Also, leave me a comment if you have questions about anything, and subscribe for more filmmaking gear, tips, and tutorials just like this one. Shoot for the stars, and I will see you in the next video.